You know how sometimes we need to count things on a web page, whether it's steps in a recipe, items on a shopping list, or chapters in a book. In web development, we often rely on the classic OL element to automatically number our list items, and it does a great job for most basic numbering needs. But what if we want more control over the counting? What if we need to number elements that aren't part of a list, or create custom sequences that reset at specific points? That's where CSS counters come in. This is Optimistic Web, where we explore the world of CSS and front-end development, one step at a time. Let's start with a basic example of an unordered list of services. Later, we'll dive into a more advanced use case involving multiple counters, something we often see in legal documents or the terms and conditions pages of company websites. Since we're using an unordered list, it won't automatically number the list items. In the CSS, we'll turn the UL element into a grid container to create a responsive column layout. List items will be styled with some basic CSS for a minimal look and feel. To use a custom counter, we first need to initialize it using the counter reset property. This property accepts one or more space-separated counter names. In our example, we're initializing a custom counter named services. You can name it anything you like, as long as it's not a reserved keyword. Then to display the current value of the counter, we use the counter function. In our case, we're applying it using the content property of the before pseudo element of each list item. The counter function accepts the counter name that we specified earlier. Let me adjust the left padding of the li to make room for the counter. Right now, it's zeros everywhere. That's because we still haven't told the counter when or how to change its value. This is where the counter increment property comes in. It controls when the counter should increase or decrease and by how much. Just like counter reset, it also takes the name of the counter we initialized earlier. So to recap, first, we initialize a custom counter using the counter reset property. Then, we define where and how the counter should update using the counter increment property. And finally, we use the counter function to display the value on the front end. The counter increment property also accepts an optional value along with the counter name. By default, this value is set to 1, which means the counter increases by 1 at each step, just like in our current setup. If we specify a value of 2, the counter will increase by 2 each time. Setting it to 5 will increment by 5. And if we use a negative value, we can even make the counter count in reverse. In all these examples, the counter's initial value was set to 0 by default. But we can also start with a custom value by passing an optional number to the counter reset property. For example, if we set the counter to start at 25 and then decrement by 1, the first visible value will be 24. Similarly, if we initialize the counter at 25 and increment by 5, the first value will be 30. And as we saw earlier, if no initial value is specified, the counter will default to 0. Now let's take a look at how we can customize the presentation. With the counter function, we're not limited to just specifying the counter name. We can also define the counter style by separating it with a comma. For example, styles like lower Roman, upper Roman, lower alpha, upper alpha, and others can be used to change how the numbers appear. We can also add a leading zero to decimal values for a more uniform look. And since we're using the content property inside a pseudo element, we can fully customize the output by adding a period, a dash, or any other character to match the design. There's also a reversed function that can be used while initializing a custom counter. However, it's still an experimental feature and currently only works in Firefox. So for broader browser support, it's better to use a negative value with the counter increment property when working with decrementing counters. Like I mentioned earlier, the counter reset property can take a list of one or more space-separated counter names. This means we can define multiple counters in a single statement. In this example, the first counter is services, and the second one is projects, which we're initializing with a custom starting value of 100. Likewise, the counter increment property can also handle multiple counters in a single statement. In this example, the first counter increments by the default value of 1, while the second counter decrements by 10. The final step is to display the counter values on the web page. Here we're using the content property inside the after pseudo element and positioning it in the bottom right corner of the list item. So this was the basic setup for displaying a single CSS counter at a time. Now let's move on to a more advanced use of CSS counters, where we can combine multiple nested counters without having to manually manage their values at each level. In this HTML markup, I'm trying to recreate a typical layout we often see in legal documents or terms of service pages. It includes a section heading, followed by an ordered list of subsections with nested list items appearing at multiple levels. With some basic CSS, it looks like this on the front end. Each list item is clearly numbered, and each nested list restarts its numbering independently. Since we're implementing custom counters, we don't need the default numbering provided by the ordered list. Now let's try to implement what we've learned so far. First of all, we initialize a custom counter. Then the counter increment property increases the counter's value whenever the before pseudo element of a list item appears in the markup. Because we haven't specified any increment value, it will increase by 1 at each step. Finally, the counter function displays the current value on the page. But it still looks like a generic ordered list, and we're not yet combining nested counters. To optimize it for a better organization, we can replace the counter function with the counters function. The counters function accepts 2 or 3 parameters. The first is the counter name, the second is the string used to concatenate the values, and the optional third is the counter style. In our example, terms is the counter name, then we're using a period as the concatenator and adding a dash symbol for presentation. As I mentioned earlier, the counters function can also take an optional third parameter to specify the counter style. In this case, we're using Upper Roman. These counters can be customized in countless ways to seamlessly match the overall look and feel of the website. So if you want to work with a single counter at a time, use the counter function. But if you need to handle multiple nested counters, use the counters function to concatenate nested values with your custom separator. I used UL and OL elements in these examples because they're more semantic and help improve accessibility for these use cases. However, you can use custom counters with any HTML elements, whether they're headings, sections, divs, or elements with specific CSS classes. Custom counters provide a powerful and flexible way to create and manage numerical sequences directly within our style sheets. They open up a whole new world of creative possibilities for displaying and organizing content on web pages. If you found this video helpful, please give it a thumbs up, share it with your fellow developers, and subscribe to stay updated. Feel free to drop your suggestions or feedback in the comments below. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next one.